Welcome to the presentation of the paper Unbounded Hierarchical Identity-Based Encryption with Tight Security. My name is Roman Langre and this is joint work with Jasheen Pan. In the beginning of the talk, I will briefly explain what Unbounded HIPE is and what Tight Security means. Then I will talk about related works, give a technical overview of our construction, and finally some ideas for future work. Now suppose Alice wants to send a message to Bob and use identity-based encryption to encrypt it. Then she needs a master public key that is issued by some trusted third party and an identity of Bob to encrypt the message. An identity can be any string that uniquely identifies a recipient, so for example an email address. And to decrypt, Bob proves to the trusted third party that he is the legitimate owner of his identity, and then the trusted third party will give him a user secret key for his identity, and with this user secret key, he will be able to decrypt messages that were encrypted for his identity, but not other messages. In hierarchical identity-based encryption, we don't have a single authority that generates all the user secret keys, but a hierarchy of key generators. More precisely, identities are tuples, and everybody can generate a user secret key for someone else if his identity is a prefix of the other guy's identity. So for example, the user here can generate the user secret keys for these guys down here, but not for the ones over here. Now usually, when you talk about HIPE, you actually mean bounded HIPE. That is, the hierarchy depth is fixed in advance. This is usually necessary because the master public key grows with L, with a hierarchy depth, or the user secret keys have some delegation terms, and these delegation terms grow with a number of remaining levels. Unbounded HIPE, however, has no limit on the hierarchy depth. This is, of course, better because it's more flexible, you don't have to fix the hierarchy depth in advance. And it's also better scalability because you only need to pay for the levels that you actually need. Here's the security game for HIPE schemes. So in the beginning, the adversary gets the master public key and then he gets access to two oracles. The first one is to corrupt a user. So there he sends an identity and gets back a user secret key for this identity. The other oracle, he sends a challenge identity and two messages and gets an encryption of one of these messages under this challenge identity. And which message depends on a bit that the challenger chooses in the beginning. And the adversary wins this game if he can guess correctly the bit that the challenger chooses. Of course, the adversary is not allowed to ask a user secret key for the challenge identity or any prefix of a challenge identity, because then he can just decrypt the challenge ciphertext and trivially win this game. Now as CCA security, that is basically the same, just that the adversary has access to a third oracle that can decrypt ciphertexts for him, except the challenge ciphertext. It's easy to achieve once you have CPA security, because there's a generic transformation for HIPE schemes from CPA secure ones to CCA secure ones. And finally, we will also achieve key-dependent message security. So that is that these messages can depend on the master secret key, because Gorg, Gay, and Hachibadi presented at PKC this year a work that showed how to achieve this for IPE schemes. And it can also be applied to our unbounded HIPE scheme. Now, what does tight security mean? We usually don't prove that our constructions are secure directly, but instead we give a reduction to some underlying assumption. And this reduction guarantees us that when the scheme can be broken with probability epsilon using some resources rho, the underlying assumption can be broken for a fair comparison, let's say with approximately the same resources rho, with some probability epsilon divided by L. And this L is called the security loss. Now, As long as L is polynomial, the scheme is considered to be secure. But the larger L gets, the larger you have to choose your security parameter for some specific level of security. So you want this L to be as small as possible. A security loss can depend on all kinds of things, for example, the security parameter or the attacker's resources, so for example, the number of user secret key queries he issues. But for tight security, we allow it only to be depend on things that the adversary cannot control, so not on the attacker's resources. So in particular, in our setting, it may not depend on the number of user secrets, not on the number of channel cipher texts he receives, and not on the actual hierarchy depth, that is the maximum length of any identity that the adversary chooses, because, well, an unbounded HIBE, the adversary can choose the hierarchy depth as large as he wants as well. Here's the brief history of unbounded HIBE schemes. The first construction was given by Luca and Waters in 2011 in composite order pairing groups, and later generalized or modified by Luca to prime order pairing groups. And Gong et al. Later gave an improvement of this scheme that basically introduced a trade-off between master public key size on the one hand and user secret key and ciphertext size on the other hand. Also, Okamoto and Takashima gave a construction of unbounded HIBE, but they only achieve a weakly unbounded HIBE. Namely, they have a master public key that is independent of a hierarchy depth, but the user secret keys are not independent. So basically, that's basically because they have delegation terms. In our work, we give a construction of unbounded IBE also in prime order pairing groups that is tied to secure. That is, our security loss depends only on the output bit length of a collision-resistant hash function in the multi-channel setting, so in the security game that I presented before. The other constructions only have a security loss that grows with a number of user secret key queries and the actual hierarchy depth, though L is here, of course, also something that the adversary chooses. And they are also only in the single challenge setting, so only one challenge query is allowed. The single channel setting is equivalent to the multi-channel setting, but this transformation is not tight. So when you're interested in tight security, it's better to look at the multi-channel setting directly. Now to tight IBE schemes. So for IBE schemes, there are a lot of constructions that are known that are tightly secure. The first one was by Chen and Hui in 2013 in the single channel setting. And later, also some construction in the multi-channel setting followed. Now, tight HIBE schemes, or the first tight construction of a bounded HIBE scheme, was given by Jiaxin Pan and me at PKC last year in the single-channel setting, and at PKC this year, we gave a construction in the multi-channel setting. Now, what's the gap to move from our bounded HIBE schemes that are tightly secure to an unbounded HIBE scheme? Well, here's one of the construction that we achieved that we presented at PKC this year. And as you can see, the master public key grows with the number of levels and also the security loss. So for bounded HIBE, this is okay because this L is not under the adversary's control. But in the unbounded setting, it suddenly is because now it's the maximum length of an identity that the adversary uses. So we need to get rid of this factor L in the security loss and in the master public key. But luckily, we can focus on getting rid of it in the master public key, then it will basically automatically disappear also in the security loss. Here's the high-level approach from of our construction. So our starting point is a tight IBE scheme, and the bounded HIBE scheme is in some sense constructed by using a different instance of this IBE scheme for each level. Of course, they are in some way, in some sense, connected together. And For our unbounded IBE scheme, the high-level approach will be to use the same instance of the IBE schemes for all the levels. Here's the basic structure of the IBE scheme that we use. So the user secret key consists of a master secret key, but this master secret key is blinded by some blinding term that depends on the identity. And this binding term is also randomized. Now, a ciphertext looks as follows and has a dual blinding term for the identity. Also, these dual blinding terms are randomized. And a ciphertext, or you can think of this as the payload. Now, that this payload is encrypted with the same randomness as the blinding term. And a property of these blinding terms and dual blinding terms is that the dual blinding term multiplied with a normal blinding term cancels out if the identities match. If not, you will get some random output. So for decryption, you use this dual blinding term multiplied with a user secret key. And what remains is basically the product of this randomness H with a master secret key. And this is sufficient to decrypt the ciphertext here because it has the same randomness. Okay, now more to these binding terms. As I just explained, they have the following property that the blinding term multiplied with a dual blinding term, this multiplication is carried out with a pairing. They cancel out, so they yield zero. Another property that is important for the security proof is that this blinding term is pseudorandom. So it will basically hide the master secret key in the previous example. But of course, it's only pseudorandom if you don't know a dual blinding term for the same value x, because then you could use the first property to distinguish a real blinding term from a random value. Furthermore, these blinding terms are publicly sampleable. But unfortunately, the dual blinding terms are not publicly sampleable. Well, they can't be publicly sampleable because then, again, you could generate one for your value x here, and this could not be pseudorandom. So you might wonder how you could generate the ciphertext then in the previous example. Well, actually, you need these blinding terms only for semi-functional ciphertext, and the normal ciphertext, so that you normally use, they will cancel out these blinding terms no matter whether it's an honest one or just a random value. But the semi-functional one that are the ciphertext that we use in the security proof, they need this dual blinding term. And the first contribution of our paper is to give a tight realization of these blinding terms. This is basically an abstraction of our PKC work. Now, here's how you can use these blinding terms to get bounded HIB. So basically what we did in our PKC work. Namely, you use L different instances. And now for all the levels. And the user secret key is now a sum of these blinding terms. And namely, for every level, you sum up a blinding term that depends on the first I components of the identity. And finally, add the master secret key. Now, you might wonder why the first I components and not only the last one, only the ith one. Well, that is necessary because only the on the last level, we will get the security guarantee that this is pseudorandom. Because for all the other levels, the adversary is actually allowed to query a challenge ciphertext, so he can learn a dual blinding term for all the other levels, except the last one. So we need on the last level all the information about the identity to ensure that this is pseudorandom. Now, delegation is here quite simple because these blinding terms are publicly sampleable. So you can delegate your secret key by just sampling a new blinding term for the next level and add it to your user secret key. Ciphertexts now look as follows. You have all these dual blinding terms. They all use the same randomness H. And Also the payload is again encrypted with this randomness H. And then you can use these dual blinding terms to cancel out all of these blinding terms you have here. And again, you will end up with a product of H and a master secret key. And this can be used to decrypt this ciphertext over here. Now for unbounded HIBE, the problem here is that now the master public key has size n times l squared. Well, n times l because the size of the blinding terms or the terms that you need to publicly sample them grow with a bit length of the input. So in this case, this is up to n times l. And the other factor of l comes from the fact that we use a different blinding term for each level, or different instance of these blinding terms. Now the first improvement is simple, namely we take a collision resistant hash function and use it to hash these prefixes of the identity here and here. And this idea was already presented in our PKC work, and this way we get this master public key size of gamma times L, where gamma is the output bit length of the hash function. Now to get rid of this second factor of L is quite tricky. What we basically do is we use the same blinding terms for all the levels. So we move this level I here. It's the same one for all the levels. But this causes some problems in the security proof. And on a high level, what the problem is that we need to do different things with these blinding terms in the ciphertext because they are different blinding terms for different values. Before, this was not a problem because these were completely independent blinding terms. But now they have the same blinding terms. And to deal with this problem, the solution is basically to use a different randomness for each level. So instead of this H that's the same for all levels, we use a different randomness for each level. But this causes more problems, for example, or basically you cannot sum up here anymore these blinding terms. So here's the final structure of our unbounded HIBE scheme. And on a high level, this is simple, similar to what also Luca and Waters did. So we have the blinding terms as before, but this time they are not summed up. Instead, we have them separately for each level, and they don't hide the master secret key, but instead we have here some additional indirection layer, so to say. Namely, each of them hides a blinding term for some fixed value, let's say 1. This blinding term has a different randomness. And then we use another blinding terms for some fixed value, let's say 2, that use the same randomness, and they are summed up over all the levels, and they hide the master secret key then. Now the ciphertext look as follows. They have these dual blinding all these dual blinding terms, now with individual randomness on each level, and also a dual blinding term for 1 that uses the same randomness as for blinding terms here. And this is added to a dual blinding term for 2. And these dual blinding terms for 2, they use now the same randomness for all the levels. And this randomness is then also used to encrypt the payload. Now, how does decryption work? Well, first of all, you multiply these dual blinding terms with the values you have up here. So that is stuff that depends on the identity cancels out. What will remain is basically the product of this HI with these blinding terms for 1. The next thing you do is you take the values down here and multiply them with a blinding or with a first value here. So then these blinding term for 2 and the dual one will cancel out. And what will remain is what you want, namely the product of this H tutor with a master secret key, but also the dual blinding terms for 1. And basically the dual blinding terms for 1 get multiplied with the randomness TI tutor that we have here. But these values are exactly the same that also remained in this multiplication before. So you just need to subtract the result that you had before from the result here. And then you get the value you want. Now to the security proof. Well, at least on the last level, these binding terms are pseudorandom, so they basically hide the binding term for one. We don't need to care about the other levels than the last one, because there we basically can use the normal way to generate the use secret key, not the semi-functional one. Okay, so this basically hides the binding term for one. And this means that we have some entropy in here, because this is now the only place where the dual binding terms for one are used. We can now move this entropy to the dual binding term for two to hide, so to say, these dual binding terms. So then the binding terms for two up here, at least on the last level, gets random. So the entropy moves up here, and there the entropy finally hides the master secret key. So that's the high-level idea of a security proof. Now here's a comparison of our unmounted HIV to previous constructions. So we have a very similar assumption, but this time with a tight security reduction in a multi-channel setting. The user secret key and ciphertext size is very similar to the previous construction. Namely, it grows linear with the length of the identity. But the price you have to pay for this tight security reduction is a larger master public key. Namely, the non-tight schemes had constant size master public key. Ours has a master public key that grows with a bit length, output bit length of a collision-resistant hash function. So basically with a security parameter. But besides this tight security reduction, our scheme is also the first one that achieves key-dependent message security with this together with this work by Garg et al. From PKC this year, because they basically gave a construction to that uses tight multi-channel secure IBE schemes to get master key KDM secure IBE schemes. And the same idea can be applied to our scheme. So it gives the first unbounded HIV scheme with master key KDM security. Okay, finally, here are two ideas for future work. The first one is whether this inject and preg strategy that we use, so inject means this binding terms that inject randomness into the used secret keys, and preg this mechanism of moving this randomness around until it finally hides the master secret key. Whether the strategy is helpful in a more general setting, so for example, for general predicate encryption schemes. And the second one is whether we can have unmounted HIV scheme with constant size user secret key and ciphertext size. Because as you've just seen, all the constructions now suffer from user secret key and ciphertext size that grow with a bit with a length of the identities. This is basically the only thing that prevents you from using the HIVE for very large hierarchies. Thanks for your attention.